Well, hello, folks. What's going on today? How you doing? Today I'm working on this actually pretty rad optimization to the game because now the game runs its tick at 60 frames a second instead of 30. The tick is always separate than the animation loop, so this is like updating all the game's variables at 60 frames a second. It always runs the animation as fast as it can. Excuse me. So anyways, they're separate. But so what this does is it basically makes the input feel more responsive. It is actually a lot more responsive. It takes the minimum latency, like for example, from your controller through the controller all the way to the game to process it. The minimum latency there used to be 33 milliseconds. So that's noticeable if you think about it. That's actually at least subconsciously noticeable, if not consciously noticeable. So by taking the tick to 60 frames a second, that brings that minimum latency down to around 15 or 16 milliseconds, which is just basically twice as fast of responsiveness of feeling while you're playing the game. That applies to both the keyboard and controllers. So what I'm trying to do right now is to make it so the game runs just as efficiently now as it did before. So before, if you look at my profiling, the tick ran at 1.43 seconds. That's how much time it used over 10 seconds of time. And after some optimizations, let's see, the next time, so I boosted it up to 60 frames a second, and you can see it immediately went from 1.4 to 2.9, about doubled, a little bit more than that. After some optimizations to the move system, down to 3.5, 3.5, and I think I've already got it all the way down to 2.29. And so the main area that is the bottleneck right now is the AI system. The AI system, the way it parses everything, uses this Cocos2DX value class, and I can write my own. This will be a lot faster in this, at least in this particular instance. So how do you get something from the git stash again? Git stash apply. There we go. Okay, so here's my work I was just working on. I don't want to compile. I do need a baseline though. Oh, damn it. Oh, that's what I would have. Oh. Okay, all right. I need to freaking get stash again. Stash my changes. Get in here. Compile. Profile. Because while I'm running game show here, the profiling is going to be different than what I was just doing before. So I need to establish a baseline. Oh, I just did this before the stream to compile against this already. Now I got to do it again. Well. Yeah, so what I'm working on is this mostly, the AI system, AI component. Behaviors used to use this Cocos2DX value type. And the way that works is this is pretty inefficient. I don't need all the features of the value type either, because only values I'm considering or even matter to me are ints, floats, and strings. This Cocos2DX class has the ability to support vectors and maps and all sorts of stuff that are totally unnecessary. And there's some other optimizations that can really be made that are specific to my AI system. So, get this ready, let's profile this, see how we're doing. Establish a baseline while game show's running and stuff. Oh, hold on. I've got to get 99 foes. I'm running 99 foes and in invincible mode, so I can get a good indicator of the move system when it's really, really, and the AI system when it's really, really stressed. so many enemies on the screen. It's just processing all these AIs, it's processing movement and collisions and all that. So this gives me a good indicator. Oh, did I not record? Of course I didn't. Hello, what's up, Sable Games and Lead Lucky? 1, 1,002, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. There we are. Okay, I got about 10 seconds of data. I'm always selecting 10 seconds of time so I can make sure and compare the time signatures. Okay, here we go. The tick update is taking 3.5 seconds. Biggest areas, AI system taking 1.13 seconds. That's what we want to pay attention to. So over that 10 seconds of time, my game only used 6.38 of it. And the AI system used 1.13. So let's take a little screenshot and name this. While I'm streaming. Okay, we're ready to start. Now I can get stash apply. And this is not going to allow me to compile. I've got to finish all this code first. So we get to doing that. The way this is going to be really efficient is if I make, I started making a val class that used a union, but I realized that that's not going to be as efficient for my AI system. So what I really got to do here is use straight up have all these values and no allocation of strings. So int val is going to be -1, float val, string val. There. Okay. Now AI component. Starts off, well, we don't need the destructor anymore. All right, see a destructor, simpler, yes. Okay, we're parsing a numeric value, sets type float, float val is parse float. Otherwise, if it's a behavior integer, the type is k int, take that int val. Otherwise, it's type k string, string val equals s. There, that's nice and simple. Unparse is gonna be even more simple now too. Got k int. Looping over behaviors, if that's it, show it. Otherwise, float, float val. This is just return string val. Actually, there. Okay, now we got parse and unparse. Now it's into the behavior tree. So the behavior tree, let's start parsing it. When it starts off, it's got a type of val, okay, null. Values clear. Values are all, wait, what's this? No viable overloaded operator equals there? What? Val type, val, val, val. Oh. Okay, so we need a clear function for these vals so we can return to its pristine state, void clear. Its type becomes k null Its int val becomes -1. Its float val becomes 0. Its string value is cleared. Is that all of them right? Type int float string. Okay, now when we're clearing a behavior, type.clear is valid. Type.type is not equal to null. Oops, no. Okay, when we're parsing the behavior called parse value, no, we don't do that anymore. There's no more of this function. No more parse or unparse. I thought I already got rid of those functions too. So moves at label get, yeah, we already got rid of those. Okay, so we want a val. Type.parse p.get key. Now if type.type is not equal to integer, type.clear. If type.strval is not starting with a semicolon, then this is a totally unrecognized type. Type.strval.cstr. Type.clear. There. Nice. We don't really need this container block either anymore. Hello, what's up, DuPont? Howdy, partner. Okay, so we're going to parse the rest of the words. Wait. Wasn't it like that? Should be okay. No matter. No matter. Name stir val. What are you talking about? Did I call it string val? I meant stir val. It's so much closer. There's shorter. Man, shorten that up. There we go. Oh, fix a lot of bugs right here. Stir val. All right, cool. We got the type parsed now. And we want to go any words after sequence or select or just strings. All right, if type.type equals k or val k. Int. Type.type dot int val. Oh, you know what? I could produce some operators. That would make this pretty nice. Oh, Oh, type dot inval. Oh yeah, that'd be sick. Okay, cool. Let's see some operators here. It's gonna be awesome. Bool operator equals equals. So we can be compared to a val. Be compared to a float. These are ambiguous, aren't they? They might be. Ooh, they might be. Let's see if the compiler is going to let me do this. I think it'll work as long as you. I do these types correctly. Comparisons, I mean. Parse, parse. So this is going to be int val equals RHS. This one's not equal to RHS. This one's float val. Hey, what's up, Adam Hunter? How's it going? This one's third val. So let me look over this, make sure I didn't mess that up. I can put a val, operator equals, not equals, equals, not gonna do yet, yep. Int, int, float, float, const, string, int val is not, float val is not, serve val, yeah. Cool, we got some operator equals is. That should make things more convenient. As long as it's not an ambiguous thing with the int and the float. Okay, back into parsing. Parsing type, parsing values. If type type is int. If now we can just go if type equals k behavior sequence or if type equals k behavior select. And this is where we should be able to see if it's going to return any ambiguous errors. It's like, oh, it's ambiguous. It's an int, not a, it's a float. Yes, it worked. It's like that is clearly an integer. You can totally do this. That is sweet. This is one of the benefits of coding in C++. I love overloading operators. All right, so this is otherwise parse a value that's what? That's just parse val, value val? Values of pushback val? Yeah, val of parse. Word's eye. If not, if val dot type is not equal to val k null, then values that pushback val. All right, we should have a few less errors. Getting closer. No match. No more name parse and coco. Not coco's too deval. Just value. Oh, this is any words after sequence. Aha, aha, okay. This is just val.stirval. Nice. Okay, so now if Vita has children, behavior B, B.parse, B is valid, children push back. Cool, we've got behavior parsing finished, I think. The rest should be just how it. Here we want to do this if we got AI verbosity, draw behavior. Another optimization I'm going to do during today's stream is to cache behaviors because behaviors are not cached at this point, which is super inefficient. Let's get saves open. What happened to saves, man? Saves, we want AI verbosity. AI verbosity. Okay. No? Isn't it like this? What's wrong with this? Oh, no game? Give me the game, man! Give me the game! Game.age! I want the game.age! Okay, up. Oh, here we go. One last thing. Part two. Draw this behavior. We want to go each for each value. Const behavior b. B dot type. This is b dot type dot unparse. Come on, unparse. You don't like that? I think this should work. Const val. Oh, okay. Unparse should be a const. Const. And then this one is for each v and b dot values. This is v dot unparse. All right. So now it looks like I should have everything done here for this. What's up, Flamingo Mangoes? This is C++. I should have all this ready to go for the AI components now. The last thing to do is to make it so the AI system uses all these new behaviors and stuff. Which means we gotta go... Oh, this is const. Yep, it looks like the rest of these errors are just in AI systems. So just getting it to use these new values, and then we're ready to try it out. Yeah! Getting this optimization going. AI system's huge, look at all this. Okay, so starting here, a b dot type. equals AI. Component val. Let's do a using at the top of all this. This is gonna get really cumbersome really fast. So using AI component val. There we go. That's gonna help. Now it could be lazy and just say val. Alright, so if b dot type is not equal to val k int, this would be an unrecognized behavior. Behavior type unrecognized, b.type.stirval. Oh my god, it's so much cleaner and clearer. All this code's getting shorter, man. I love it when code gets shorter. What do you mean? I just did using val. Doesn't like this. Oh, dynamic. Oh, I don't have AI component. Duh. I don't know, AI component in the AI system? Can't refer to a class member. Using val equals, you like this maybe? Huh, you like that? I know this is possible. Ooh, hey, see, there it goes. Nice, it liked it. Yeah, we got past this. All right, cool, now we got short code here. All right. Int type equals b dot type dot inval. So this is switching b value 0.type, right? Yeah, this is just, change all these to val, k int. Change all these, type float becomes k float. And val string Okay, string. Oh man, it's good to use your own systems. So good. All right, so this is b value 0 dot int val. Actually, let's do another string replace. So as int becomes int val. No more? All right, have it your way. As float becomes float val. And as string becomes dir val. And then switching all these, a get type is just going to be that type. That should be all for the conversion part of this. Refactor, oh, still got bugs. What? Two more bugs? What? No member name, unparse, because there isn't. So this is b.type.unparse. Same here. Values subtype. So I guess that would be val subtype. Oh, you can't initialize a val that way. So we'll go val underscore subtype dot inval is subtype, and then we can just go subtype dot unparse. Okay, and this is, oh, we got subtype 2 as well, subtype 3. Just a little debugging here. Type 3, subtype 2, 3. Come on, no whammies. Yes. All right, let's see if the AI runs. Still, that's going to be a big step, right? If it still runs correctly, then hell yeah, I did it all right. But if something's wrong, we got to fix it. Let's see. Something's wrong. Nothing is moving anymore. All the AI is like, I don't know. Jib moves. Okay, well, let's start figuring it out. First thing, I'm going to look at the console and see if, see that? Behavior type unrecognized? Everything is unrecognized. That's going to be a problem. Wait, one of these recognized. Something worked here. But everything else didn't. What's the one thing that was okay? Dude, that's a lot of unrecognizes. Jeez. That's a lot of behavior tree parsing. No, dude, this implementing a cache here is gonna really help. Can't believe I never did this. Ahoy! Salad dogs! Tell me you fixed it, man. Tell me you fixed it. Okay, what's this one? Select, sequence, Sequence. This looks good. Target ran. Yeah, this looks like the behavior tree for the dude. So you kind of fixed it? Yes, man. Yes. Oh, this is great. So you kind of fixed it more than yesterday? Or the other day? See, there's something with the behavior trees. Parsing. Checking out an old commit that's still. You okay? I like the way this is going. Tell me there's a dot 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 though. Oh, good. And now I'm in the process of adding back in the changes. Ah, great. Okay, man. Yes. You're on track. You got it. Oh, man. That's good to hear. I was kind of worried for you. I'm like, man, Salad Dogs is in the weeds right now. Dealing with the crazy bug. How about we start by looking at the one behavior that's unrecognized? Yeah, you will. You'll find exactly what broke it. And then you'd be like, oh, are you serious? It was that? Oh, man. That's going to be a triumphant moment. Behavior type, space, unrecognized. Unrecognized. Wait, what? Really? Oh, it's AI system. Okay, so it's like there's an AI, something didn't parse correctly for it. Thanks, Flamingo Mangoes. An upshot is that I did find out about a debug extension. Really? Wow, if it does it work? Can you actually debug? Can you finally take the blindfold off? I'm thinking I'll take the time to implement use of that extension. What is it then? What kind of it lets you get information about what is going on? Okay. Well, that sounds a lot better than just GL check error. All right, we need to assert that the type parsed correctly. Got some behavior parse funk. Apparently became part of the core in 4.0. Oh. Nothing, we never got that, but somehow we got the AI system. Oh. Is it this? Might be there. Take a little doing. Yeah, there's a lot of jellos here, but they're all just dead. They're like, ah, I don't feel like moving. Because I'm not finished with this AI upgrade. It wasn't that. Why the hell? Why the hell are these guys just stuck? Stuck doing nothing. Well, I'm going to start here. Start where it's parsing behaviors. Behavior.parse. Behavior.getChildren and stuff. This feels like going back too far. It's drawing a behavior that has a. So really, we should set this breakpoint here, or this assertion, behavior.parse. Assert. Behavior.type.type. There, that's what I want to catch. I want to catch this situation. What could it be parsing that has nothing? Duh, what? Okay, well, this is weird. Maybe I'll go to AI system here and set a breakpoint right here. Because obviously it's like, oh, I made a mistake right here. This behavior, I'm pretty sure this behavior is okay. It is, it's got a type one. Yeah, what I did wrong here was I compared the b.type, but this is supposed to be the b.type.type. Hopefully all the AI just works now. Yes. Awesome. All right, phase one of today's refactor is finished. Let's see if this runs faster, as it should. I'm gonna turn off AI verbosity though. Make sure there's no like, yeah, okay. It just exported a bunch of these. But see how it parsed the behavior for every single one of those guys. Which is really inefficient. All right, let's do, we got our baseline from before, which was AI system tick took 1.13 seconds. Songbringer took 6.3 overall for 10 seconds. So I wanna see if this AI system tick goes down, should be less than 1.13, or at least around there. All right, what do we got? 10 seconds, that's close as we can get. Oh yeah, look at Songbringer took only 5.8 that time. Come on, tell me the tick is faster. What's up, Gaius Nexus? Hey, don't worry, man. When you're starting out, like, sometimes you struggle. Everybody sucks at everything they do the first time. I've been doing this for over 20 years, man, so I should be this good by now. If I wasn't this good by now, you should get your money back. Not that I'm taking anybody's money for this. You can't pay me money for this. I don't make any money on advertising. I don't make any money on subscriptions. But I will make money from this game. Chuckle, chuckle. Yeah. Give me all your money for this game. Check it out, it worked. It's a lot more efficient already. So it went from 1.13 down to 880 milliseconds. And I got another optimization to make too. So, phase one complete. Okay, after, during the stream, one. There we go. So we went from 1.13 AI system tick to 0.88. All right, this is a good point to check in. This first little bit of refactor. Yeah, I've never done tic-tac-toe before. Checkers is also another one of those things. It's a little harder than you'd think. A simple arithmetic calculator, yeah. So val parse, type null, inval, float val, stir, parse the inval, parse the stir val, unparse. Type. Oh, let's get rid of this behavior type funk thing. Don't want that. Check it in. Bloom. See ya. Oh, and we only want to do this if the behavior does actually parse. We're going to need to pass in a name here, too. All right, let's go. Behavior parse, parse children. There. This. Commands for calculator. Oh, yeah, stack. Totally. Stacks are kind of abstract. What? Why doesn't it just do draw behavior? Stack Overflow, here I come. Yeah, man. Yeah, Stack Overflow is a great resource. No denying it. So awesome. I use Stack Overflow all the time. Constantly like, wait, what the hell? What? We'll just call this desk. Maybe just draw. Actually, we'll call this debug draw or log. Yeah, log's a good name. It's log. It's big, it's heavy as wood. AI component behavior log. Oh, stop compiling. Because we need depth. Log in depth. What's up, space my name? I know. Sometimes it's totally useless. You're like, what? Oh, with the complex stuff like that. Oh, I know what you mean. This log. All right, so type.unparse values for autoref child and children. This log. Oh, damn it. This needs to be a static function that takes a behavior. All right, static void log. Const behavior. Can we do a const behavior here? I think so. Const behavior of B. Wait. AI component behavior. Log. Thank you, Amarok Dota. Appreciate you saying that. So log this. All right, there. That's a little more organized. Once again, I'm just trying to check in phase one, and with phase two, I'm going to cache these behaviors so they're faster. Should be and a lot more memory efficient, especially. Yeah, dude, it'll be so much faster loading. So right now, if you walk onto a screen with 100 different enemies, it goes and processes 100 different behavior trees every single time. For every single one of those, too, it stores all that memory for all those. So it's just going to be way the hell more efficient to do it this way with the caching and using behaviors from the cache. Because behaviors never change. Once they're parsed, they never change. Yeah, so what I'm doing today, if you guys are just joining the stream and stuff, like my whole purpose today is I've taken the game's tick, and the tick is separate from the animate. So there's an animate tick and there's a tick tick, and the game's tick tick is where it runs all the stuff, like the collision system, the movement system, the input system. Everything in the game's tick tick used to run at 30 frames a second. Now it all runs at 60 frames a second, so the input is twice as responsive. So basically, the game like used to have a minimum latency for your input of like around 33 milliseconds. Now, since the tick runs at 60 frames a second, there's a minimum latency of only 15 milliseconds. So all the controls in the game feel way more responsive, whether that's a keyboard or a controller. So what I'm doing right now is I'm trying to make the AI system and the movement system twice as efficient, basically, so that the game still performs as well as it did at 30 frames a second doing its tick. So if you check this all out, before I started today, the game's update, or its tick tick, took 1.43 seconds. I've got it down now to 2.4 seconds, so I've still got a little bit of ways to go. And actually, I might not be able to hit that goal because I'm already at... No, wait, this is because I'm running... This is during the stream. Yeah, after I stop today's stream and run another last performance thing, I think I should be able to get the tick-tick back to about 1.4 seconds, even though it's running twice as much, which is pretty significant. The main thing I did for that was to make the movement system have a variable number of iterations. Right now... Or before, it had a constant number of iterations. It always did like four. Whenever there's an enemy and the enemy moved like the slightest tiny bit, it would go four times checking the entire collision system to make sure that enemy could move there and there and there and there and there and there and then finally to its ending position. So now it uses a variable system where it decides at runtime like, oh, I really only need to do one iteration here. And so that's a hell of a lot more efficient. And then now I'm just making some subtle optimization, not subtle, but like just, you know, optimizations to how the AI system parses itself and runs itself. And I think this should all make a pretty good difference. And then all of that, like I said, is just to make the game feel twice as responsive as it used to. Okay. So with, is the AI system verbose? Let's turn on AI verbose one last time. Make sure that still works. Can draw its behaviors. it's so long. Look, 17,000 lines. This is so parsed, so many of these. But yeah, it's drawing all these correctly. Here it's drawing a behavior tree as it parsed it. All these are other behavior trees. All right, let's close that. Check this all in. Just looking it over, make sure I didn't make any mistakes. I already looked over this parse and unparse, and I already checked that that works. Oh, I love that it has operators. That's pretty cool. But I did get a bitten in the ass by it one time when I accidentally compared. I wonder if I should do... Oh, I just got a great idea, actually. You discovered a new Bray style? Yeah? What's that? Is it cool or is it funny? Yes, you know some of these words? Yeah. Okay, I got an idea. If I make this a strong type... There's enum type. Then I can have an operator equals for the type. And then I won't make the mistake of accidentally comparing it. One more little steez. Type RHS, return type equals RHS, do the type, dot, 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 type, 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 dot, dot, dot. It's called the I wish this was Python style. Oh my God. Oh yeah. Where's the braces, man? Where's the braces? Oh, I'm lost. So there's either, is that a basically a compiler error or like a coding error with that swap after that permute? I don't get it. There's no braces. Or are they just invisible? Are they invisible braces? Are the braces at the very end of the line off the screen? Look on the right. Oh, is the image? Maybe the image didn't. Oh, the image was like. Oh, okay. The image I had to scroll right on my iPad. That's crazy. Who would do that? Who would do such a thing? All right, so now if I go into my AI system and I try and repeat that mistake I made earlier. If b.typed equals not equal to int, this should be okay now. You should turn your assignment like that. Yes, do it. Do it. Make your teacher laugh. Come on. Yeah. All right. Cool. Everybody's behaving. Yeah. That's good. Now that's kind of like way more rock solid. I can do this without... Yeah, that's awesome. I could even do it right here. But type.type, it's okay to go ahead and be explicit about. Okay, good. That's just a little insurance right there. So it keeps me from messing up. Compare a value class, object, struct. It should be a struct. Tell me that's a struct. Good, it's a struct. Okay, I was like, I don't want to actually use a class. Classes, man. Classes are for OOP programmers. Parse, yep. Unparse the operators. Type dot clear, parse. Val. So if type.type is int and type.type equals behavior sequence or behavior select, val.serval equals words I. Oh, yeah. It's just copying the name of the val. All right. Otherwise, parse it. You almost wrote your dynamic array library as a class. You're like, oh. All right, this is so much better. Faster and better already. Part of the way through, I was like, wait, this is stupid to make this managed memory the way I want it to, at least. It resulted in more to type out, right? Ah. Val kid int. So even though I did fix this, I should probably just keep that explicit. Keep that as type. Yeah. What's up? Have you heard anything about Jai lately? I'm like, what? It's taking too long. Yeah, encouraging the coder to use new. There's a lot of problems with C++. But I still like it. Okay. That's good. Yep. Really? You think it's going to be years? You're probably right. It's going to be like 2020. And then we're all going to be like, oh, okay, now we can use it. Okay. Git commit. Source. AI component. Whoa. AI component val. Custom val struct. Woo! All right, phase one done. Okay, next phase, I'm going to go for improving the speed of this particular section of code right here. I'm pretty sure this is a performance bottleneck because AI system tick, behave. Everything about behave calls all this stuff, which grabs everything. Behave always calls at least, it always at least does this section of code. So there, I've got a way I can improve the performance of this bit right here. We got a drink of water though, man. I'm going to talk a lot. Oh, actually, I should do the behavior tree parsing, or I mean the caching first, because that'll make a big difference. Memory and loading speed wise. Actually, let's get a little baseline on that. What was the last run I did? Wait, the last run I did was out of AI. Verbosity. Let's see, verbosity 0. Just gonna run it and see how long it takes to load. Maybe I'll do it a few times. I'm not concerned about world creation. I'm talking about here, game scene creation. See, the game scene took 1.24 seconds, but it was already up for 3.6 seconds before it even did anything. Let's run it a couple more times to see what kind of the average is there. So it's about the same. The problem here is that it's reparsing all these behaviors every single time. If there's 100 enemies, it parses the behavior 100 times, which, text parsing, doing that over and over and over is just ridiculous. About 3.5. Let's just focus on that number. 3.5 to 3.7 about is what it was. So, behavior tree caching. We're gonna need to know the AI component's name, because that's how we're gonna. Wait, I could do like a hash function on each behavior, which could maybe be like. Oh, yeah. I could do a behavior hash. Instead of having to pass in a name, and then the map would, I could store all the behavior trees in a cache based on their hash. Hash it, cache it, blam! That's all we need. Okay, so AI component.h behavior, we're gonna have a function called uint64 hash const. Should be all we need, actually. And I really should have a hash type too. Type dev uint64. Uint65? How about 65? Can I get 65? I hear 65. Can I get a. Right. Log parse hash. So hash type hash equals 0, or hash type ret equals 0. Return ret. So ret plus equals type dot. Oh, this is gonna be another one that's freaking recursive. Oh. Okay. So this is going to be another recursive function, static hash type hash, but it takes a behavior. Doesn't need a depth though. Okay, now we got it set up for recursion. All right, so red plus equals type dot type. Right? Type dot type. It should be compiling so far. I don't know why I'm getting errors. So we need a type dot type. No, type dot int val is all we need. Type dot int val. And then for each one of the values, red plus equals type dot or v dot, wait, what? You still got errors. Oh, static member count of a const qualifier? No wonder it compiled twice. Ret plus equals v dot type plus v dot inval plus l round f v dot float val plus v dot stir val dot size. That should be pretty good. It's kind of like a round little hash or whatever. Conflicting types for hash again. And then for each one of the children, child and children, ret plus equals child, no, AI component behavior hash child. Remember, turn ret. There we go. We should have a hash function all set up. So that'll loop over everything in the behavior tree and add up all of the values and stuff and produce a hash value. Oh, this is B dot type. B dot values and B dot children. Yes. No. Oh. Oh, this isn't even gonna work because basically, when it comes in here to parse, it starts with a val tree, not a freaking hash value. Oh well, that means I have to take every single AI component and we need to pass in a name. when we create an AI component. I guess we can keep the hash value. Not gonna need it though. Set mood. We're not gonna parse behavior. We only parse behavior here. So new AI component, mood crow, mood birds, dude, I got get child, this is mood boomerang out, mood explode, and mood jib. There's only one instance where it ever uses this, and it already has a profile name anyways. Oh, could have saved myself 15 minutes here. All right, so AI component, this constructor needs a name, const string ref name, so we can use that for caching. We don't need the hash, we just need the name. Now, we're back in area creation. We're gonna pass in this profile name whenever we parse a behavior. There we go. Okay, so back here in AI component, we need to take that name. Nanim, such a good typer. Name. Okay, and also behavior is gonna need an operator equals. Right, do we need a copy constructor as well? So we copy the type, which means val needs an operator equals. We're going to copy all the vector values, which means they need an operator equals. I'm wondering if when you do a C++ vector operator equals and a copy, do you need a copy constructor? I don't know. Let's just try it with the operator equals at first, I guess. Cons behavior ref. All right, Jess. Type equals RHS dot type. Inval equals RHS dot inval. Float val equals RHS dot float val. And stir val equals RHS dot stir val. Type inval, float val, stir val. Yup. That should be good. Okay, now we need AI component behavior ref, AI component behavior operator equals. And that just copies the type values in children. So type equals RHS.type, values equals RHS.values, and children equals RHS.children. Oh my God. Oh. I don't need any of this, man. Oh. Cuz I just want to I want to use the value in the map. I want it all to point to the same memory. There's no need for operator equals this. God damn it. I've been wasting a lot of time here. Oh well. Let's get rid of that. Get rid of that. Right? I know, man. This happened twice in the last 10 minutes. Like, whoops. Didn't need that. I guess I should be thinking ahead a little bit more. I should be playing more chess in life. Just control percent, pretend nothing happened. Do, 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 do. Nothing happened. Nothing to see here. Move along. Okay, all we need is a map. Static map. String to behavior. Just call it behaviors. There's our behaviors cache. Really? What? Add component behavior, behaviors. There. There's the cache. Compile everything again. Man, I love compiling. It's the best. Okay, so if active, parse behavior and or just get the behavior. Auto. Nope. Yeah. Auto ref. Oh. Don't compile yet is one more thing I gotta do. You create an enum and make it integer based. You get compilation errors if you try to assign a variable to that enum type with an integer value. Oh, are you talking about strongly typed enums? Because if that makes sense, if you're doing a strongly typed enum, right? You don't want it to ever. Yeah. There's a good reason. So if you have a strongly typed enum, that makes sense. But if you have a not strongly typed enum, yeah. Well, you don't ever want your a strongly typed enum. It's not an integer. You don't want it to be considered an integer. You can get around that by static casting, though. But that's the whole point of a strongly typed enum, is that you don't want to accidentally compare it to an integer or copy it to an integer or, you know, assign it from an integer. Definitely a good thing. That's the whole point of strongly typed enums, I think. I don't know everything about C++, but that's how I use them. Yeah. Okay, so I need to decide if I'm going to make, if a behavior now is going to be, well. Yeah, I think I can get away with a behavior being a, an AI component's behavior can be a const behavior ref. I think. Let's see if this works. So we would have a blank behavior. Oh, this, okay, yeah, so you have a specific situation. You created an enum. Oh, for bit flags? Yeah. Oh, you couldn't use bitwise operators on the values defined in the enum. Yeah, I get you. You would just want to not use a strongly typed enum there, I would think. Because, you know, bit flags are different because they're not just 0, 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So I think I could just go. We want to initialize behavior with name.empty. Or. Name.empty or behavior is null. D- then we want to use the blank behavior. Otherwise, we want to use the behavior's name. And then if active and the behavior isn't valid, then just parse it. Oh, so this can't be a const. One more compile. One more, right? All right, there. And then if you're creating an AI component the other way, you would just do behavior is a blank behavior. So there, that should do it without using pointers. Only references. I love references, man. I wish that everything was a reference. You never had to check if things were null. But of course, there's a lot of situations where you gotta check and use pointers. If I define a strongly typed enum and define one of its values to be 0x80, I think the compiler should know what I mean when I try to bitwise OR that value. Ah. Alright. Okay, is this it? Am I done? Have I cached all the behaviors now? There's one error. Two errors. Oh, there's one more AI component? Oh, this is the blank constructor. All right, so this is AI component, val tree, comma, behave, comma, right? Do I use a comma or another colon right here? I can't even remember. We'll find out soon enough. Oh, whoop, wait, what? I think he's another tweaks in the colon? Yeah, but why would you want to use a strongly typed enum there? Oh! This is just a string. Why isn't this working? I wasn't even calling the right constructor there. Okay. So, it looks like we're compiling. I'm going to try and run it now. And then what I'm going to do is turn on AI verbosity to make sure it's not printing out like 1,000 different parse behaviors again. And then I'll... Oh, yeah. Another thing I should do is when it does AI verbosity... It should show behavior number or whatever. Oh yeah. All right. Well, there you go. I hear ya. Enum foo, k foo, k bar, f Foo Baz equals Foo Zero, right? Now you got a wrong Baz. And Baz equals K Foo or Bar. Yeah. Cache illustrates it very, very nicely there. If you could use bitwise operators like OR with strongly typed enums, then you've got a situation where a strongly typed enum does not represent a single value, which is crazy. Crazy, man. Okay, let's see if the game even runs. Okay, let's turn on AI verbosity. See how many of these it parses. Make sure I didn't make any memory errors here. How can I verify I did this correctly? Guess the first thing I'll do is just see how much data it's pumping out here. Cache behavior number four. See, wait, no. Why does it keep on saying cache behavior number four? What? Oh, it's drawing that every single time it does. Wait, no. Yeah, it's doing it every time it does behavior parse, which behavior parse is recursive. So we want to do something like this. Every time it actually parses, we'll do a little. Little of that. Yeah, that's the point of it. So, because you want to be able to, you want your strongly typed enums to not ever be a value outside of that. It's like that's the point of like knowing that your value. Whoa, did it's like slow down there? Let's set another like new line here too. Okay, no, I didn't actually slow down or anything. I'm fake. Okay. Now we can look at the output. I wanted to be my own in the first place, but wasn't using the right syntax. Cache behavior number six, cache behavior number five, number four. Yeah, man, this is way more efficient. It's not loading and parsing like 100 different behaviors for 100 different enemies. What's this one? Behavior number three is long. Behavior number two? What happened to behavior number one? There's no behavior number one. Now that's weird. Oh, because it already did behaviors. Okay, that makes sense. So I don't need to do plus one here. Yes, now there's only six behaviors total. And if I go to the next screen, if I go to the next screen, there will only be six behaviors loaded. Or once it's already loaded a behavior, it doesn't need to ever go load it again and just keep it in memory in its cache. I probably should have a behaviors purge. I'll do that in a second though. Okay, so how could I verify that I'm not making any memory errors here? I mean, I'm either using blank behavior, which is just gonna be a blank, small, there's no children, no values, or it's gonna be referencing behavior's name, and I'm verifying that name is not empty and the behavior is not null before I do that. This is the only time it will ever insert something into the behavior's cache. And then it just goes and parses it if the behavior is not valid yet. This makes sense. I guess I could run into an error, or not an error, but like a situation where if I specified a weird name, or an unparsable behavior. That's something I should check. What if there's an unparsable behavior? Let's go to Blobs3's behavior and just see what happens if I call this select. I forgot AI verbosity. So all the blobs are dead now. That's fine. Let's see what happens to the cached behaviors. Oh, that's a good way to do it, cache it. I never thought about doing it that way. That's a really great thought. Cache behavior number 6. What about, is there any kind of unrecognized? Yeah, cache behavior number 1. Unrecognized behavior type select. Aha. Okay, so that's the situation I was trying to illustrate, is that if it can't parse it, it's still going to keep trying and trying and trying and trying because that behavior is becoming invalid each time, which is okay. But what if I left select off and all of these sequences were bad? So let's just delete the rest of this guy's sequence and just call his thing here sequence. I think this is okay. Cache behavior number 1, it parsed it and then never parsed it again because it did have a single, yeah, so it was like, hey, I can't recognize this one thing, but since it had one single child, it was a successful sequence. So I guess I could, if a behavior is parsed incorrectly, I could assign an invalid behavior rather than having to try it again and again. Let's go back to this select. So we go behavior parse so if the behavior is not valid after parsing then we could push back a single value or something. Oh, this probably belongs inside the behavior parse. No, I mean, what that'll do is if I push back some value to try and make it so it never parses it again. Then the AI system isn't going to know that that's an invalid. It'll just try and run it anyways. It'll always be trying to run an invalid behavior, which is not what I want. I guess I could have an invalid type. Yeah, we'll do that. So there's null, which is the default. Oh, I could just have behavior parsed. There we go. And we would have AI component static void purge. There we go. Okay, so now I've got a way to define a behavior that's can always define if a behavior has been parsed and it can still be invalid. Ah, that's beautiful. Okay. All right. So now we've got whenever we call behavior parse, we'll go parsed equals true. And then AI component can go if active and the behavior is not valid and the behavior is not parsed. Yeah, there we go. And then we also need an AI component purge. And we can schedule that from game.cpp. So does the game keep behaviors cached throughout execution? Yeah. You're going to purge them on some basis. Nope. No, there's no need to purge the behaviors ever during the game because the behaviors are all... They should be constant. I should actually make them constant variables, but... the behavior never actually changes. So the... for example, like Blob 3... This behavior tree stuff never ever changes. It might have random values and stuff like that that it uses at runtime, but all of this never ever changes. So there's really no need to ever purge it at runtime. I'm purging on exit just to kind of be like a good programmer. I know that's not entirely necessary on most operating systems these days, but I'm just trying to deallocate everything that I did allocate because, just because. Does anybody have any insight on that? Is that actually necessary anymore? I know, for example, it's definitely not necessary on iOS because iOS just purges your memory for you. Or does it? Maybe I'm wrong about that too. I don't know. I figure it's a good practice just to delete everything you nude, to free everything you malloced. Oh, they do, yeah. What's up, baby? I'm just streaming. I don't know. Do you have something in mind? Well, are you near Whole Foods or something? Maybe you could grab a salad from Whole Foods or something hot from there. I could just have leftovers. I got beans and stuff I can cook. All right. Yes, grab yourself something. Yeah. All right, baby. I love you. Okay, this happened right this time. So it loaded the behavior once, and it said, this is unrecognized. But it only parsed it once. So it didn't try and parse it over and over and over again. The other behaviors, it parsed correctly. And it parsed what looks like 6 of them. Now, if I go back to the blob and just... take this and make it just select. All the blobs should come back to life. And the number, what was the number at the beginning here? It was like 3.5. Yay, the blobs are alive. Okay, here we go. Here's the moment of truth. I'm gonna run it and see how long it takes to load. Forces you to think about the termination of the program and the resource management. Yeah. Right? I think it's a good practice as a programmer to do that, huh? Okay, how long did it take to load that time? Longer. It took longer than it did before. Whatever that means. Maybe it just didn't have anything to do with it. The load time really wasn't affected that much by. Or do I have something else open? What's up? Best of three, huh? Yeah. Right? Yeah, you're not relying on that. What if that other piece of software that's supposed to free all your memory messes up? Huh, this doesn't seem to be much faster. But at least I know that it's not trying to parse a million times. Right, yeah. If the OS has some bug, then it's gonna leak. And it's really your fault. Okay, I'm happy with this. I got behavior tree caching. It seems to run at about the same speed as it did before. I would have hoped for a little bit faster load speed there, but you know, I know that it's not parsing a million times. So that's good. Just make sure I didn't break anything. So I got a map is a cached. That's a behavior cache. It's a map of strings to behaviors. I got a blank behavior. Behaviors have a parsed variable. I got this behavior hash function, which I don't need. Gonna comment that out. No need to compile code that you're not using. Okay, so now when it loads an AI component from a behavior, it has to pass in a name, and then it goes and assigns its reference to the behavior from either the behavior's cache or the blank behavior. And then if the behavior has just been gotten from the cache and it hasn't been parsed yet, then it goes ahead and parses it. This is good. Can't believe I had not done that before. Right? All this whole last year and a half or 2 years or whatever making this game, it always reloaded behaviors. Every single room you went into, it would just load behaviors from disk every time. Okay, now we are at the moment where I can go and profile once again. Why isn't my fan still going though? Oh, because I'm coding. Source kit services when Xcode indexes. All right, we're back to a nice little easy state here. Game shows using a good amount of CPU, so we can do this test. I believe we're gonna have a good profiling session now. I'll go product profile. Make sure, wait, no AI verbosity. Good. Product profile. Let's hope it runs faster now. One thousand two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. 10. It's a lot spikier. Sometimes it's a good sign, sometimes not. Oh my god! That is more efficient. It's already down to 6.21 total. Wait, am I just getting excited over nothing? Maybe I didn't remember this number. Tick update, tick tick. AI, yeah, the AI system is using less than the movement system now. Awesome. And I got another optimization I could make to the behaviors. One last little touch. Let's see if I can get this down even lower. But still the tick ticks at 1.4 seconds. I guess I do have to compare that to my computer running without game show. Okay, so this is after stream 2. Okay, one last optimization. I want to make it so a behavior tree has a num values, and then the values there's always at least three values so that when the behavior tree goes to run its behavior, it never has to go and check if there are three values in order to get the to get an index into three or whatever you'll see from the AI system. So this is one last little thing that should improve the AI system even more, but probably not. It's probably not going to affect things that much. So a behavior has an int num values, and then values can be a vector which can be bigger. Sometimes if there's like no values, but I want to have a minimum of three values in there, so we have to use the num values for however many values there actually are. All right, now when we clear, got num values equals 0. Parse type, parse values. Here's where we push back to the values. We'll go num values plus plus. Here we ensure at least a few values. Faster, this makes for faster AI system behave. For int I equals 0, int I is less than k min behavior values. We'll set that up as a variable here. Values dot push back val. Constant came in behavior values equals 3. There we go. So now we got, now each behavior has a num values integer, and then you can just push back as many more values as you really want if you want some blank values in there. And this is going to make the AI system faster because I guess we can go auto ref num values equals b dot num values. No need to change all this code. And then subtype. These are all going to be auto refs. Actually, this could be a const auto ref. Const auto ref. All these should be const auto refs. Subtype is going to be b values 0 dot int val. Subtype 2 is 1 dot int val. Subtype 3 2 dot int val. So float const auto ref float val 0 b value 0 float val. So since we've guaranteed all these, oh, we need to guarantee at least four, actually. B values 0, 1, 2, 3. Const auto ref stir val, same kind of thing. Now we don't need any of this. Oh, so much cleaner. Looks like we're gonna have a few errors, probably that we're using one of those floats or whatever. Yeah, we changed subtype here. What's up, Rob DeSwan? Thank you for hosting. Dang, man. What's up, Rob DeSwan? How you doing? So I want to just capture the subtype here. Wait a minute. So I've already have like type as a variable here. Yeah, type is the b.type.inval. Thanks, Rob the Swan. I appreciate it, man. I guess I could just call it T. Auto T equals subtype. And then this is going to be T equals behavior rand. And then from then on in this little bit, I go subtype, convert that to T. It's okay? What's okay? You just knackered finishing your stream? Right on. What'd you do on your stream? Now I gotta make sure I did all the right values here. T, 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 T. I think that's right. I hope I didn't break this. T, yeah. This is one I'm particularly concerned about. If T is greater than or equal to S and less than or equal to southeast. Yeah, that works. You just get the first visible results of a high detail models in your voxel world? Oh, sweet, man. Oh, yeah, I remember your game. Cool. How's it going? What's up, charged bit? Do you know all the programming language in your head, or do you just use references? I know most of it in my head. I've been coding for like 20 years now, so it's going pretty well. Sweet. This could be a compass stir cast. That'd be smarter way to do that. T. Yeah, so T should be okay there now. If I can keep it running decently while making it look better, I'll be very happy. Nice. Yeah, you going for a Kickstarter? I think that's awesome. I highly recommend doing Kickstarters. Verify as soon as possible, too, in your project. So we'll go auto T equals subtype. So we can make a read-write copy of this variable here. So we're not modifying the behavior. And then T equals behavior brand, and then the rest of these need to be convert subtype to T. I think that should be it. Yes, yeah, I did a Kickstarter. Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah. Yeah, I did do a Kickstarter, and I did I did write an article about it. Let's see if Botfu's here. I think Botfu is here today. Gamma Sutra, I think that's the command. Maybe not. You there? Oh, crowdfunding. There it is. There you go. Yeah, that's kind of my experience from the Kickstarter. I kind of put it all in a Gamma Sutra article. T. Okay, we should be okay. Let's run the game and make sure nothing is obviously broken. All right, everybody's moving around. Looks like you're okay. Wait, some of these guys look like they got stuck. They did. Some of these guys got stuck. Oh, they all got stuck now. I think I definitely messed something up. What did I do? Kovarni, what's up, man? I need scissors. Proton, where do you buy those sound effects? I don't buy sound effects. I make sound effects. I make sound effects with Ableton and Massive. Those are the two things I use mostly to make. Invalid kills, how did you learn to program? I learned from books. Chakma, did I write the engine myself? Well, it depends on what you consider an engine. I did not write the underlying OpenGL engine or the sound engine, but yes, I wrote the entire game engine from the ground up. This is how many lines of code so far are there in Songbringer? 73,906 lines code. Is there a beta release date? Yeah, the beta's already out. Is there a final release date? No. Yep, you can play the beta if you want. It's all, you can, all the information's at songbringer.com/preorder. Just songbringer.com if you want to go there. It's a pretty obvious link to pre-order if you want. And if you pre-order the beta version, which is the $32 version or whatever, you can play it right now. And you get a Steam key right now, and you can play it. Yeah, yeah, Isokarma, this is C++. Nice, you did a stream and a podcast. You ripped into the indie winging mentality? What you mean about winging? Oh, whinging? Oh. Good, man. Good. Good. Yes. Too much whinging out there, right? Definitely. All right, Rob the Swan. Thanks, man. Cheers. Yeah. Don't whinge. Don't whinge. Just do stuff. Do stuff. Make games you love. There's no need to whinge. Okay, I just tried to create some optimization here. This is what I've been working on this whole stream is optimizing my AI system so it runs faster. It is running faster, but all these blobs are getting stuck now, which means I probably just made a mistake in this very last little bit of code I just did right then. In fact, I can verify that. Oh, I could totally just undo all these T changes. Because there's really no need to just assign these to a reference. All I need to do is go auto const or just auto subtype. There, I can copy all these integer values instead of trying to create a const reference. There, let's see if the blobs are now working again. Mortars? Yeah, this is C++. C sharp plus plus? MATLAB. It's lolcat. Have you guys seen lol? Is it lolcat? Wait, what's the lolcat language for programming? Okay, blobs, keep on moving. Keep on grooving. Keep moving around the screen. Don't die. Don't stop moving. Okay, I think they're okay now. I'll play around with them a little bit. Send out some bombs. Yeah, that was. Wait. Wait. There are a couple guys that are stuck over here. No, they are getting stuck. Why are they getting stuck? Ah. Right. Okay, well, let me see if this actually made a difference. It might not have even made a difference. Or I might have actually made a mistake in the last check-in. All right, I've got invincible. I want to go make sure this is compiled. Make sure AI verbosity is off. And now I'm going to profile. Right, profile. Because if this didn't even make much of a difference, there's really no need to check this in. 1, 1000, 2, 1000, 3, 1004, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, I do too, Indie Pillage. I mean, it does have type ID, but that's not really. It's so hard to parse type IDs. You're like, wait a minute. You can get a little bit of good information out of type IDs. But yeah, there's a lot of features that C++ does not have. But it is one of the most widely used game development languages. Pretty much every, like for example, Steam's API. Steam's API is all C++. It just makes it pretty easy to write your game in C++ because then you don't have to worry about it when it comes to other systems. Yeah, this did help. Oh my God, look at that. The AI system tick is all the way down to 498 milliseconds now. And the overall Songbringer is only using 5.6 out of 10. Okay, this does represent an improvement. This does definitely represent an improvement. But something went wrong along the way. Let's take a little screenshot. You like Rust? This is Twitch. Oh. Big Black Clocks. Nice name. I love it. Yeah. Okay, after stream three. All right, so it's definitely faster, but I've introduced some kind of bug. I'm thinking maybe it might have been this if I just use float valves right here. Oh, also, yeah, that should be enough. Wait. Subtype 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Why are all these guys just dying all of a sudden? Yeah, Kovarni, Rob the Swan was hosting there for a second. Okay, so the problem is, so if you guys are just tuning into this stream, this game's called Songbringer. It's a procedurally generated game, so you enter six letters when you start your adventure, and that generates an entire, like, Zelda-like universe for you out of those six letters. So every time you can play a different world, or you can play the same world again. So what I'm doing today is I'm optimizing stuff because I just made it so that the inputs have less latency. So instead of them having 60 or 30 milliseconds latency, now they have like 15 milliseconds. So I want to improve the speed of the game now that I did that, because it basically is running the tick faster or more often. So they're still getting stuck on the side. Damn it. Okay, I guess the first thing I should do is just make sure that... Hold on, let's stash this as it is. Do I play games? Yeah, I do. I love playing games. I especially love retro games. Like retro pixel art games. Like my favorite game of 2015 was Axiom Verge. My favorite game of 2016 so far has been Hyper Light Drifter. You know, I like those kind of games. I don't really like, I don't know. I'm not really into 3D games that much, or AAA games. But that's probably just because I don't have a good system to play them on. Okay, so I can stash this. It's a pretty short commit, right? Yep, I'm a big 2D player. Yeah, I like Binding of Isaac. I like it. I'm not so much of a twin stick shooter type of game fan, but Binding of Isaac's pretty great. I definitely got hooked on it for a minute. And when I finally beat Mom, I was like, it crashed on me though. Like, it sent me right back to the main menu after beating her, and I'm like, no way, I finally beat Mom, and it... Anyways, it's a pretty good game. I like Edmund McMillan. He's a cool guy. Seems like a cool guy. Hotline Miami? What's that? What's Hotline Miami, but isn't Hotline Miami a 3D game? Yeah, I have checked out Owlboy. I haven't played it yet, though. What do you guys think? Has anybody played Owlboy? I would love to hear some thoughts on Owlboy. If anybody's played it yet. Like, some games, they look cool, right? You're like, oh, that looks like my kind of game. And then you play it, and you're like, dude, the controls suck, or the gameplay sucks, or the AI sucks, or something just as stupid about it. I'm wondering if Owlboy is a really good game through and through or not. Oh, Hotline Miami 1 and 2 are 2D? Really? You did? You've been playing it? Nice. What's up, Cheeseball Lord? Oh, I never knew. I thought Hotline Miami was like a 3D game. It shows you what I know. This reminds me of, like, Prison Architect or something. Okay, let's see if now going back in this one commit, if the blobs are fixed now. Really? Oh, and it was made in Game Maker, huh? Okay, you blobs. They're looking all right. What if I go, if I turn off invincibility? No, wait, they did. The blobs failed again. Oh, this must mean I broke it earlier. What did I break? So is it when they I start hitting them? Oh, is it when they? Oh, look at that! Look, they all just started like going out and going to the edge of the screen all of a sudden. Oh, it's because I killed one of them. This is weird. Well, okay, it's good to know that it wasn't this latest bit, so I can at least unstash. Well, I think that's going to be it for today's stream. I did get a lot of progress made on making the AI system faster and stuff, but I got to take a break now and just relax for a minute because I don't know what I broke there that made that all the blobs get stuck like that. I think what I'll probably have to do is go back in time, like a bunch of git commits, and see like if that bug was actually happening because of the code I wrote today, or maybe that bug was there already. I don't know. So yeah, I'll figure it out here eventually, but so yeah, that's gonna be it for today's stream. If you're new to, if you've never seen me do a stream before, thanks for watching. Thanks to everybody for watching. But if you haven't ever seen me do one, I do streams about this time every day, and I'm always working on this game here called Songbringer and stuff. It's a C++ game. I don't know what I broke there. Story of my life, right? You and me both. We're both going to be going back through our Git log, going like, okay, let's try this Git commit and see if it's broken here. Oh, good luck with that, Saladong. Seriously, man, I can't wait till you break through and you get your code all working with your engine. That's going to be awesome. Breaking code is what I do best. Right on. Oh. Yeah. All right. So thanks a lot, guys. Cheers. Have a great night, and I appreciate all your support.